President Carrara, can I just say, we've heard from the commission about the desire to...
It's 37, I think, 36, 37, February 21st, 2018. But do I need to... No reportable items out of closed session. Sorry, Kevin. Do you need to close? I thought we had to adjourn closed session. Okay, is there a motion to adjourn closed session?
I move that we adjourn.
Second.
So, Sabrina moved, Robert second. All in favor? Well, roll call. Roll call.
Commissioner Mathews?
Aye.
Commissioner Brennan?
Aye.
Commissioner Lorenz?
Aye.
Commissioner Bernardin?
Aye.
President Chankaro?
Aye. So that passes unanimously, and so now we're in the regular meeting. If we can do a roll call, please.
Commissioner Bernardo?
Here.
Commissioner Brennan?
Here.
President Chankaroli?
Present.
Commissioner Lorenz?
Aye.
Commissioner Mathews?
Here.
Okay, so we have a quorum. Staff recognition. Steve, did you want to, or John?
Turns over to John.
Item 2B, staff recognition.
Good evening, Commissioners. I'm very happy to announce the district hiring two new employees, Manuel Zepeda, please stand up.
Welcome.
And Eric Aronson. Both were recently hired as harbor worker bees and they're stationed at Oyster Point Marina. Both are from the local area, Half Moon Bay. Manuel worked at a local restaurant prior to coming with the district. Eric worked for Coyote Point Recreation area. Huh? So both have been doing an excellent job for us. We also, in an effort to hire from within and motivate our staff, very pleased to announce the promotion of Connor Cakebread.
Congratulations.
Connor has been working as a harbor worker here at Oyster Point, at Pillar Point, since March, and now is at Oyster Point as a deputy harbor master. Glad to have you.
Cool. Thank you guys for the opportunity. It was definitely didn't expect that in 8 months, and working over there, I had a really good group of people over there, and I look up to all of them, so hopefully I can fill their shoes. I got a lot to learn, but I'm excited, so thank you.
Right.
Connor earned his promotion through a challenging, rigorous, both written test and physical testing, and Connor came out above the competition. His reputation, he's earned an excellent reputation as a harbor worker, working very hard for us, and we really appreciate that, Connor.
Yeah. Thank you.
Congrats on your new jobs and the promotion. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, any other comments real quickly from Commissioner?
No.
Okay.
Oh, I have Commissioner comments.
No, I mean in response to item B. Any other congratulatory comments? But, okay, so going on to
thanks
item...
Thanks very much, the three of you.
Yeah. Item C, public comment number one. This is for... members of the public who wish to comment on items not on the agenda, and I have two speaker slips. James Hahn.
Good evening to the commission. It's good to see you again. I wanted to address my comments to Commissioner Mathews. I saw the meeting video of last month's meeting, and I was disappointed with some of the board dynamics. As part of your last meeting as board president. In that meeting, you called fellow commissioner Brennan someone who pathetically lies consistently. I will remind you that you admitted yourself that you sent her emails, that email with the pornographic images, and you admitted yourself that you invited her on a private trip without your spouses. This is something you've admitted. You should not be calling her a liar. And I'm also a little disappointed that part of your defense for sending her these images was that, well, she's a lesbian, so obviously she'd be okay with pornographic images. I'm a gay man. I've had straight men grope me and say, oh, it's just a joke, or you guys like that sort of thing, so what's the big deal? Just because people aren't straight doesn't mean we have boundaries or that we don't have professionalism. And that kind of attitude, that kind of defense kind of shows the kind of relic that you represent and the kind of outdated views that really need to be purged from this board. I'm asking you again to resign, and I'm asking you to, since you probably won't, if you do stay on the board, to please comport yourself with a little more dignity, because you have a lot of nerve calling someone a liar for someone when they've been vindicated. I also want to call out President Ciancarelli, because during that meeting, you called Commissioner Brennan the reason why the district is in the situation it's in today. That is classic victim blaming. She was standing up for herself as a victim of sexual harassment, and you called her the problem. You and other people who are working for this district, including the general counsel, are complicit in creating a culture of silence. I will remind you that despite the fact that there is a report on this sexual harassment claim, it is not being made public, it is not being made available to us, and you as a board have the power to vote to make it public. If you don't agendize that, if you don't discuss that, and you don't take a vote, you are all complicit in the culture of silence that is leading up to the massive problem around sexual harassment that we are seeing today. And thank you to Commissioner Brennan for speaking out about it. I just want to point out that one of my biggest concerns about the fact that this process has not been transparent is that I've been at many of these meetings and I've seen interactions between the district's counsel and Commissioner Brennan enough to know that I don't believe that any investigation which general counsel is overseeing, your in-house counsel, is going to be a fair one.
Thank you, Mr.
Thank you.
Thank you. Our second comment, or public comment, is from John Olin.
This is so disgusting. This is so hard to talk about. So I'm going to just try to stick to how the board should handle this situation. This report needs to be released. It should have been agendized tonight. And I can't imagine why it wasn't agendized this evening so we could get this out of the way. This all could have been dealt with months ago if people just been straight, people had just admitted what happened, people apologized for what they did if they felt it was wrong. But here we are tonight. In today's review, you can find where Commissioner Matouche quotes from part of the report that no one else is going to see and claims that the report does not sustain any of the allegations made against him. But that's just not true. I mean, I haven't seen the report, but I've seen the pictures. And how many, Ms. Corrali, how many emails have you received from people that had pornographic pictures of women splayed out, displaying their vaginas? I know it's hard to look at me when I say something like that because it is shameful. Robert, has anybody been sending you pictures of pornographic women or men showing off their anuses? Probably not. And I suspect you've never sent an email like that. So for Commissioner Matouche to come out and cherry pick one comment out of the report and not acknowledge the pictures. Robert, would you like to see the pictures? Because I do have them, but I'm afraid I'd be rightfully kicked out of here if I were to display them to you or to these people back here. So have you all seen them? Any of you? Okay, well, we'd like to see the report. The editor of the Towns paper has called for it. It's not really a radical thing to ask for. And I'm hoping that you all will have the courage to make it available to us. The world has changed. We don't protect people anymore. When this stuff happens, we don't have our boards and our good old boys circle each other and protect them. If the report makes it clear that Sabrina, or you did nothing wrong, Mr. Matouche, that report needs to get out there. And if it shows that there's a lot of blame to go around, the report needs to get out there. And if the report shows anything like these photos that I've seen, it definitely needs to get out there. Thanks.
Thank you. I only had those two public comment slips for items not on the agenda, so we can move to commissioner comments. I know that Ed had something to say. We can start with Sabrina. Do you have any comments?
I do, yeah. I'm not sure how this mic worked. Is this mic to the video?
No, there's a speaker right here.
Okay. So earlier today, I sent out an email to the board of harbor commissioners and our management staff, and I copied a few folks on it. Some of you have seen it already. And it's basically a rundown on a meeting that I attended in Sacramento at our state capitol last Thursday. So I'm going to read that email that I sent to the board this morning and management staff. Dear Harbor Commission and Harbor District Management, last week I attended the Joint Assembly and Senate Committee on Sexual Harassment Prevention and Response. It's a subcommittee of the Rules Committee under both houses. And then I've included links to video of the meeting. So I'm going to read the transcript. For the Joint Subcommittee on Sexual Harassment Prevention and Response. This was on Thursday, February 15th, 2018. I'm Sabrina Brennan. I'm a Harbor Commissioner in San Mateo County. I am speaking today as a member of the public. I can tell you from personal experience that complaints and investigations are severely mishandled at the countywide special district that I represent. Thank you for your service and for the opportunity to make the following remarks. There should be a uniform anti-harassment, anti-discrimination, and anti-retaliation policies, laws, whistleblower protections, education, and training across state and local agencies. In-depth anti-harassment, anti-discrimination, and anti-retaliation education and unconscious bias training should be a requirement for all elected and appointed representatives and government employees. Current training lacks information about best practices for conducting independent investigations once a complaint is made. All harassment, discrimination, and retaliation complaints should be investigated and the findings should be transparent. Types of inappropriate behavior should be clearly described and consequences should be well defined. Doing this would help move cultural norms in a positive direction. A panel of three or more people should select investigators, and the panel must include both women and men. The complainant and complainee should be provided with copies of all investigation reports. A panel or a review board that includes both women and men should make recommendations about disciplinary action. A commission or a statewide elected board might be a logical option for reviewing investigations and determining outcomes. An appeal board could review decisions in the event a complaint or complainant or complainee was dissatisfied with an investigation or the outcome of an investigation. Recently, I've been in conversation with Neil McCormick, director of the California Special District Association, about the need for anti-harassment, anti-discrimination, and anti-retaliation training that includes best practices for conducting unbiased and independent investigations. However, I'd like to point out that it's not reasonable to expect that local agency associations like CSDA, the League of Cities, or an overburdened state oversight agency such as the Fair Political Practices Commission will be able to correct a long history of sexual harassment, gender discrimination, and sexual orientation discrimination in the workplace. And it's worth noting that many of those organizations lack gender diversity, racial diversity, and sexual orientation diversity in management practices and positions, organizational governance, consultants hired to provide training, and newsletter, website, and social media content. This pandemic has been overlooked for far too long. A comprehensive statewide plan for addressing these complex problems must be thoughtfully developed, prioritized, and funded. It's critically important that workplaces throughout California be safe and free from harassment, discrimination, and retaliation. I applaud your efforts to search for creative solutions. Thank you. I've also included in this letter to the board and management staff information about the spectrum of sexual misconduct. Kathleen Kelly Reardon, who's a PhD at emeritus at University of Southern California Marshall School of Business, spoke at the joint committee hearing in Sacramento that I attended, and I've attached to this letter her spectrum of sexual misconduct, which breaks down various types of offensive behavior into categories and helps make it clear what's inappropriate and to what level of inappropriateness. So I think this is good information to have. I think there needs to be a lot more work done in this area, and I think our district in particular has failed when it comes to our approach to sexual harassment, gender discrimination, sexual orientation discrimination and retaliation complaints. We failed miserably. We have had a biased and non-independent process, and there's a lot more I could say about that. And I would also like to confirm that, yes, I have read the investigator's report as of today. And yes, it does confirm that Commissioner Mattouche sent me an email that contained 9 highly pornographic images. And he also, it confirmed, which I already know, invited me on a trip to Tanzania, Africa, to go hunting on a safari,
so Sabrina,
which I declined. Minutes. Thank you.
Thanks.
Ed?
I'm going to break from my tradition of starting off with some of the things that I've been up to and go with my comment on this topic, and then I'll go to what I've been up to. So I've also read the report on sexual harassment complaint by Commissioner Brennan against Commissioner Mattouche. The report's a result of an investigation guided by what I believe is a flawed policy. In other meetings, I've called for that policy to be changed before we proceeded with an investigation. Its confidential nature, I believe, serves no one, and it definitely doesn't serve the district or the public well. And so I believe that we should release that report, because that's the only way you all will understand what's at stake and be able to judge the conclusions of that report. Okay. No, I'm not done. I'm switching gears now.
Okay.
So I'd just like to give you all a quick update on what I've been up to. So Keith Mangle, who's in the audience now, he and I attended the Northern California Beach Water Quality Monitoring Workgroup meeting. There was a paper discussed on the incidence of gastrointestinal illnesses following wet weather recreational exposure, meaning if you go surfing in water that's contaminated with bacteria, what happens? And they showed a direct correlation between bacterial counts and surfer illness in this case. It was a nicely presented and nicely done study. If any of you want copies of it, I can get them to you. They also had a discussion on human fecal contamination score and ranking for recreational sites, because they're looking into how to deal with that for a number of reasons. And I'd be happy to talk to you all about that if you want some more information. So later in the month, I went to the Pacific Sea Level Rise workshop. The reason I went is because I feel I need to learn more about how people are thinking about sea level rise. And I believe also that we should be looking at climate change, because sea level rise is a consequence of climate change. And there are other issues that relate to what happens in our area, especially in the harbor, with respect to climate change, like more intense storms or even droughts. I was happy to see that Charles Lester was there, hired by the City of Pacifica, and also Environmental Science Associates, who I believe are very good at what they do. They're a consulting firm. And Talitha, who's in the audience, was there with me. Then I, February 20th, yesterday, I was in Sacramento. I spent the day with ocean and coastal environmental protection advocates, visiting members of the state Senate and Assembly. We were there to talk about what's going on in the world of ocean protection. And from the point of view of a harbor commissioner, I feel it's important not only to educate myself on what's going on, but also to lobby for policies that protect the ocean. One last thing, we have a climate change resilience committee meeting later this month. It's February 26th from 6 to 8. We'll be talking about the project on Surfers Beach sand replenishment. Our consultant will be there to talk about it. Just to give you a quick preview, we're still searching for a place to put the dredged sand, and that's been a big problem for us. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Tom. Who's going to go down the line?
Oh, okay, I'm sorry. No, go ahead. In 2014, Sabrina Brennan and I were friends before I was elected to office. I sent an email to 40 people and included Sabrina after talking to her about it. I regret sending that distasteful email to anyone and the unnecessary publicity that has brought to the Harbor District. I apologize if it offended anyone.
Okay. Mine is about PowerPoints. And I just want to take this time to talk about a pet peeve that I have as someone who does give public presentations for a living. And that is, please, I urge you, of course, you could do whatever you want, but if you're going to do a PowerPoint presentation, please don't just read the bullets off the PowerPoint, which I could do on my own time or I can do in an email. But instead, tell us something that's not on the PowerPoint. That's just my peeve. So just presentation skills 101. Thank you.
So I have a final comment. One major thing, and it's kind of in response to one of the public comments tonight, but for an item not on the agenda. In November of 2016, I received an email that had pornographic links to it by a member of the public who is sitting in this room tonight, which was also sent to the Board of Supervisors, and someone responded and thought it was on the borderline of cyberbullying. So I had to take that on the chin. This was during an election year. That's not even really the issue. The issue is that as a member of the public, you have a right to say whatever you want to me or any elected official. That's our part of our job. And you know, I respect that right, but I hope that people recognize that cyberbullying, sending pornographic links and pictures. I don't even know what these movies are. I didn't even open the links. I was so offended by them. And intentional, too. That's part of my job. That's all I have to say. Okay. The consent calendar, item D. I know that there are two items that Commissioner Brennan would like to pull off. Is there anyone else who wants to pull off any item? Ed? Tom? Okay, so Sabrina, you wanted to pull off item 1 and item 12. So that can go to the end of the agenda. So that means that we can approve. Is there a motion to approve items 2 through 11?
Actually, I should say that I don't, how do we usually do this? I don't want to vote on the minutes because I haven't had a chance to review them.
Pull them off?
We can so pull them off. Let's pull the minutes because I can't vote on them.
Which ones?
I haven't read any of them.
Okay, so items 2, 3, and 5.
Yeah.
Okay, so we'll pull off items 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 12.
And Commissioner Chancarella?
Yes.
I believe you have public comment slips on a couple of the others.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, that's right. Okay.
If they've been pulled, they can get discussed.
Yeah.
Okay.
We'll pull. They've been pulled, so.
Is 9 pulled? Because I submitted 1 for 9.
Sorry, James. No. 9, yes, 9 and 9 has not been pulled. So I can hear public comment now on that item.
Could we just pull 9?
Sure. Okay. So the items that have been pulled are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 9, and 12. So if there's a motion to approve items 6, 7, 8, 10, and 11, I will entertain a motion.
So moved. Second.
Okay. Any discussion? Okay, roll call, please.
President Chancarelli?
Aye.
Commissioner Bernardo?
Aye.
Commissioner Lourenes?
Aye.
Commissioner Latouche?
Aye.
Commissioner Brennan?
Aye.
Okay, motion carries unanimously. And we will go to the discussion items. Starting with item 13, San Mateo Resource Conservation District Partnership Update. John?
This is a recommendation to receive report and update from the San Mateo County Resource Conservation District. This is an information item only. No action is required. Since 2002, Blue Point Harbor has been included on a statewide list of contaminated water bodies due to its high fecal indicator bacteria concentrations, which are indicative of pathogens harmful to humans and can come from any warm-blooded animal, including pets, humans, and wildlife. The contamination continues to cause beach postings. In 2008, RCD initiated the Phillip Point Harbor Source Identification Project, commonly referred to as the RCD Pollution Study, to help characterize sources of bacterial contamination in the harbor. To follow up on this study, agreements were adopted between the district and RCD to further address this issue and other water quality concerns by monitoring various water quality parameters within Phillip Point Harbor, as well as stormwater outfalls flowing into the harbor from upland. The District Board of Harbor Commissioners approved entering into a 3-year agreement with the Resource Conservation District in May 2016 for an amount not to exceed $146,370 through fiscal year 2018-19. The total expended thus far has been $121,370. Most recently, testing has revealed possible sources of contamination that were unanticipated. RCD has led an effort to ensure the integrity of stormwater and sewage pipes leading to the outfalls, as faulty pipes could cause cross-contamination and/or pollutants entering the stormwater pipes from groundwater. RCD will submit a proposal for additional monies to address the unanticipated additional costs not covered in the additional agreement, which will be brought back to the board for consideration. At this time, I'd like to introduce RCD representatives Brittany Bolke and Kellex Nelson, who will give us an update presentation and answer any questions on their efforts and findings. Kellex and Brittany.
Thank you for having us. So before we start with the presentation, and Commissioner Bernardo, I'm racking my brain to think if there's any slides here where we need to read the data. I just want to say how very much we are enjoying our partnership with the Harbor District, with your exceptional staff, and the kind of support that you have given to the RCD to be able to support you in your management objectives has resulted in leverage of resources from many other entities as well, and a real coalescence around finding solutions in the watershed and in the harbor. And it's been a real pleasure for us. And I feel like we've actually gotten to the point where we've got a lot of traction and are figuring things out, because we've been able to put some energy into this for a long time. And I also want to give particular credit to Brittany, our water quality program manager, who is a Columbo out there really investigating and figuring everything out. She's the one often that's out there in rain or in dry times figuring out what's connected to what and who she should talk to and doing that kind of sleuthing to figure out solutions. So thank you for having us. Brittany is going to provide for you an update on where we are with the program. That is figuring out some of the water quality impairments and what's contributing to the harbor, focusing primarily on what you have funded, but also talking a little bit about what others have contributed as well. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Felix, and thank you, you guys, for having me. All right, so we were last here in June, and so we're coming back 6 months later to kind of give you an update of what we've been up to. We have been following up on the next steps and recommendations that we discussed in June, which has mainly consisted of mapping out the stormwater system around Capistrano Beach, as well as cleaning out the stormwater lines and inspecting the condition. We've also been taking part in various education and outreach efforts, such as meeting with the Coastside One Water Group, putting storm drain stickers, as you can see up in the right corner there, on all of the drains in the harbor parking lot. And we've also been doing a lot of pet waste education and outreach, pet waste cleanup events and things like that. We also have been continuing monitoring. We did our annual first flush event this fall with our volunteers, which is collecting water samples during the first big rain of the season. And of course, continuing just to identify sources of bacteria coming into the harbor through various mechanisms. So here's the table that we presented to you guys in June, and it's pretty much what I just explained. We've been mainly inspecting stormwater and sewer lines, as well as cleaning them out and the education, outreach, and sampling. And then you can see the various partners that we've brought into these efforts. So just a reminder, the picture on the left here is kind of the situation we're dealing with the underground infrastructure, stormwater lines, sewer lines, water lines, and trying to figure out how everything is, you know, laid out and interacting and potentially influencing one another. So the pictures on the right are the work that we did this fall, or summer and fall, with our contractor, which included lowering a robot down into the stormwater lines and camera, sending a camera up there to kind of assess condition. So here's a map showing the areas that we focus on. So you can see we did the green is what we focused on Harbor District property. So those were all those lines were cleaned and inspected. And then over here on Capistrano Road, as well as Prospect Way, the county paid for inspection and cleaning of those stormwater lines. We also did some dye testing of the sewer lines in this area to see if there were any interactions. So what we found was, first and foremost, just getting a record of what was going on with these systems as far as the layout and the drainages, which actually hadn't been done, and that's something that's pretty crucial to managing this infrastructure. So getting that inventoried and getting the condition recorded was a big part of this. And then throughout the process, we also did find specific vectors and aggravators of pollution. So whether that was a specific source of water that was contaminated, or finding a source of water that was clean and then getting dirty. So we actually found a lot of different scenarios. In the Harbor District system, we did find some broken and failing stormwater pipes, as well as some lines that were clogged with fats, oils, grease, other debris, and some connections to the system that would be transporting pollution into the harbor. In the county system, we also saw some things that were considered few vectors or aggravators of pollution. They were just a little bit different and related to groundwater, as well as we saw a lot of pipes connected to the stormwater system that were, we did not know where those came from, and we weren't able to find out because it was on private property. So we also tested sewer lines with dye, and we actually did not find any evidence of sewer lines leaking into the stormwater system in this area. So here are some pictures of the work that we did. The picture on the left is down in the harbor parking lot by Tenant Row. And you can see they're cleaning out the system, and they found that big, that's a big piece of styrofoam. Ooh. That was down there in the stormwater system. And there was also a lot of just debris, and this is actually, there's a creek that runs through this stormwater line. So you can kind of see how this might be an aggravator of pollution. And so here's some other pictures of the pipes. You can see a lot of corrosion, pipes that are actually broken where the soil is showing and groundwater is coming through. This is a picture of groundwater infiltration into one of the county pipes. And that's kind of, that's an example where you have your stormwater system and maybe you have a connection coming in that's not related to a storm grate that's catching rain. It's something else.
Such as?
It could be like a wash down area. It could be a sewer lateral, all sorts of things. So here's a summary of the results in the harbor area. This is just a zoom in of the harbor parking lot. So there's the maintenance building, there's Tenant Row. So what this is showing is kind of a summary of what we found. Now the red and the orange lines are showing stormwater pipes that have the highest, what they call pipe rating, meaning that the systems are pretty much failing in those areas. They're broken pipes or they are corroding. So these are the areas that we've identified as needing some attention in the near future. And then this whole line here has a creek running through it. And this is the line that was completely clogged with oil and grease and debris. And so we actually weren't able to finish inspecting this line or clean it out because we didn't have enough money or time. And the contractor estimated it would take about 10 days probably to clean out all of that grease.
Really?
Yeah.
Could you tell me a little bit more about what you mean by a creek running through it?
Sure. So you guys know where we are, right? Like Barbara's fish trap is right here.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So Capistrano Beach, there's three watersheds technically that flow to Capistrano Beach. And one of them is Denniston Creek, which flows by Mezzaluna. The other one is Capistrano Drainage, which is, we found out through this investigation in the past 6 months that that's really just a source of, it's really just groundwater. There's no creek there. It shouldn't be flowing during the dry season, but there's a crack in one of the county pipes and groundwater is coming in. And the third source of water to this beach is St. Augustine Creek, or San Augustine is what some people call it. So basically the creek starts up at, is up in the headlands, and it's culverted underground up at Montecito and Balboa. And so from that point it goes underground and just has, is supposed to have storm grates for the rain to connect to it. But we did find some other things that were allowing grease and oils and things like that to get into the line, to the line. Okay, so kind of switching gears, I'm just gonna let you guys know about the little bit of monitoring that we did the past 6 months. You can see that, you know, as we're continuing to work in this area, this has been our focus area. We took some samples there, and then we also have some of our first flush sites. So just a summary of what we found at our first flush sample sites. Bacteria, again, is the highest pollutant of concern in all of basically the Midcoast region as well as Half Moon Bay. And the sites that have had the highest counts and the sort of the biggest issues have been Capistrano as well as Surfers. And then after bacteria is orthophosphate followed by copper and zinc. And it's cool because now that we are actually getting, you know, eight, nine years of data, we can really start to parse out some trends. And what we're seeing now is that West Point is kind of popping into the picture when it comes to pollutants besides bacteria, such as nutrients like phosphate and metals. So it's just something to be aware of and something that we're going to want to keep in mind for the future.
Where's West Point located again?
So that's the road is. It's over in Princeton. It's the road that leads to the SAM pump station or the Surf Rider lab.
Wasn't there something? Yeah, there it is. Okay, it's the outfall there.
Yeah, it's actually a ditch.
Uh-huh. That's a really nasty one. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it floods too during rain events in that area.
Can you tell me a little bit more about the exceedance rate number?
Sure.
What is that?
So every pollutant has a water quality objective for actually a different beneficial use. So if you're going to drink water, that's going to have a different objective than if you're going to swim in water. So we use like a recreation objective for bacteria. We used a aquatic life, I believe, water quality objective for the metals and nutrients. And so if it's over that objective, that's what we call an exceedance. So it's basically you're not staying under the goal. You have much higher concentrations of these pollutants.
So what is the benchmark?
Sorry, I just wanted to add one little thing onto that. So unlike when your kid gets a report card and they've exceeded objectives and you take them out for pizza, this is the opposite. So the objectives here are thresholds that you don't want to surpass. And as Brittany was saying, they're tied to what's called beneficial uses, meaning why does it matter is basically beneficial use. So with bacteria is an indication, since bacteria comes from the intestinal tract of warm-blooded animals, bacteria themselves are not necessarily a risk, but they're an indicator of potential pathogens like viruses. The concern there is about public health. Some of these other things, the beneficial use is about maybe marine life or aquatic organisms, reproduction, that sort of thing. So these thresholds that are set by different agencies for different types of concerns.
And that number, say the 98 for the bacteria, that's derived, or it says that 98% of the times you tested it, it exceeded that.
Right, and so that was at, so usually we do a more in-depth presentation for first flush.
Yeah.
But here what this table is showing is at our what we call our historic sites, which are a subset of our sites that we've been monitoring since 2008. So basically that 98% is saying that at seven sites, which include the ones on this map,
mm-hmm.
All seven of them have exceeded the bacteria objective all eight of those years.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I think there was one sample one time in the past 8 years that didn't, or something like that.
Like Alex says, if this report card would have been spectacular.
Okay, and just some other findings from all of the work we've been doing the past 6 months. When we've been looking more at Denison outfall and the influence of the stormwater system that actually connects into the creek by OPL, by Old Princeton Landing. So we actually have found that that system coming from the urban area is probably contributing more bacteria than we previously thought. I know people have talked about the creek and the farms and the wildlife and things like that. And so we want to just remember to keep in mind also the stormwater system that is connecting into that creek. So Capistrano Outfall, as I mentioned, we found the source of water that's coming out of the pipe in the dry season. And it's groundwater coming in through a crack in the pipe on the north side. But what we don't know is if that water is coming in already contaminated with something or if it's getting contaminated by something in the pipe. And we're trying to parse that out right now with the county. St. Augustine Outfall is the one that runs through Harbor District property. And as I said, I talked about the debris and the fog inside of the line. And we have seen bacteria upstream of that, probably from wildlife or dogs, some background levels, but it does seem like it's getting higher, the bacteria is getting higher once it hits the section of line down in the harbor parking lot. So we're also doing a microbial source tracking work with San Mateo County. Yeah. They have decided to allocate some of their resources for their stormwater permit to Pillar Point, and so we're taking the samples for them and help them write the monitoring plan, and we're going to have the data back in June, and that will be for human and dog markers to basically see if those sources are prevalent, because those are the most controllable sources, really. Okay, so next steps are to fix the broken and failing stormwater pipes and the clogging of the lines on harbor property. And we've also been asked by Harbor District staff to do this work for the rest of the property south of Johnston Pier. So mapping, cleaning it, and inspecting the condition. And then, of course, continuing to work with our partners, such as the county and Surfrider, as well as educating the tenants and harbor staff about best practices related to water pollution, and then continuing to scope and implement solutions. So as John mentioned earlier, this is just a little rundown of the budget. This was a three-year agreement that started in fiscal year 17, and so you can kind of see how much we've spent to date. And a lot of this was because we had to, the first year, we kind of had to figure out what it is that, what made the most sense as far as next steps and recommendations, and that turned out to be working so closely with the stormwater system and actually hiring a contractor. So we have a remaining budget right now of $30,000, and so to do those next steps, such as fixing the broken pipes and continuing to inspect the rest of the harbor infrastructure, we're preparing to do that for the rest of this fiscal year and fiscal year 19. So I'm gonna put together a scope of work and budget for your guys' board meeting next month. That's it.
Great. Any comments, questions, discussion?
Yes.
Please, Ed.
You want me to go first?
Yeah, unless you want, I don't care whatever y'all wanna do.
Well, first of all, as you know, but also I think it's good to state it publicly, you guys just do spectacular work. I mean, if you go back, roll the clock back to 10 years ago when we first started thinking about source tracking and we got some monies to do it, you guys worked that out. The technology wasn't quite where it should have been. You did a good job with that, and then water was still contaminated. You know, we've been on the beach, that particular beach has either been number one or number two on the beach bummer list almost every year. And as, from what I see and what I've seen from working with you guys is that we're now heading to solving that problem. And it's been spectacular work. And it's easy to put a PowerPoint presentation up and show a map of where these storm drains are and where the sewer drains are. But it's a huge amount of work. May not look like it when you just look at pencil drawings, but it's an incredible amount of work, and it's also takes a lot of organization. So I'm super happy that you guys have been working with us. I can't see that we could have found a better group of people to do it, and really appreciate your work. So with questions, this may not be a politically fair question to ask you guys, but I'm asking it anyway. There is a number of restaurants that sit along some of these storm drains, and their waste treatment practices in some cases are not that great. And since we are the district's water, or the receivers of the not that great practices, when they clean their grease traps and in some cases where they have their garbage, do you have any recommendations on how we might approach dealing with that problem? And then a related question is, can you tell me a little bit about what the impact of things like grease trap fats and other associated garbage that goes into the storm drain, and what is that impact on bacterial contamination?
So regarding outreach and education about best practices, we've already started in our existing agreement with you, and it's already been beneficial. And this is also where you have a lot of leverage, of course, as the landlord, and we've been working with your staff on that, and they've been really helpful, and we're already seeing some improvements as a result. And I anticipate that we'll probably want to do some more of that. And I think also if we're able to do some of the additional scoping of lines, we may have some additional recommendations.
Mm-hmm. What about some of the businesses that are not within our leases? You know, like on the west northwest side of Capistrano, just as an example.
Right. Yeah, we've actually been in conversation with some of them, uh-huh. And it's actually one of the things that the RCD is able to do uniquely in this area is work across jurisdictions and boundaries, including with private landowners and private operators, and as well as public. We've been having a lot of those conversations, and we're trying to be scrappy and resourceful about the funding that we've got and how to make it work so that we can integrate these pots of funds and efforts for the most leverage and to be able to get the most outreach accomplished. The original funding that we had that you referred to, that original study, was great, but it was very restricted to very specific tasks.
Yeah.
One of the huge benefits of the way that we've been able to work with your district is that it's been more open-ended in allowing us to follow where the path leads instead of what the task and the contract like prescribed before we actually knew what we would find. And so between that and some of what the county is contributing in some of our other programs, we're able to work fluidly with some of these folks.
And
the part two.
Yeah, I was just thinking about part one too. I think that honestly, I think that there's also a lot of new faces in the community when it comes to caring about this issue, and the meeting of the Coastside One Water Group, which is Sewer Authority Mid-Coastside and Surf Rider and us and the county, different branches of the county. I think that you know, people care, and I think that it will start to gain traction as far as the larger community starting to adopt some of those best practices. And we have reached out to them individually as well. And so I think that there will be change when it comes to that.
And thank you for pointing out who that organization is, because I forgot to ask. It's a really good thing that's going on.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And I think your second question was about if things like grease and oil and stuff stuck in the pipes can contribute to bacteria. It's really interesting because obviously when we're talking about bacteria, we're talking about fecal bacteria. So you wouldn't necessarily think that it would impact that those types of conditions would impact it, but I think that it can, just because of the sort of secondary conditions that it creates with the oxygen and other chemical processes. That's kind of what our testing has shown right above that issue and right below.
Yeah.
So that's really the best that we're going off of right now, but I guess time will tell as people, you know, do more studies around that.
Another way of saying that as well is even if it's not a source of bacteria, it may create the conditions for the bacteria to grow.
Thank you.
So thanks for being here tonight. You guys always do a really great job on your presentations, and I don't think you've ever read right off the slides before. So good job on that. I'm wondering, like, where do we go from here now that we know we have such a significant infrastructure problem? One of the things that we've been discussing as a board recently is overhauling Johnson Pier and making some significant improvements there. And it seems to me like after hearing this, we need to be looking at more of a comprehensive overhaul at Pillar Point Harbor regarding infrastructure. So I think given that we're embarking on our strategic planning process and tonight we have goals, what's it called, goals and
just goals, 2018 goals.
Goals, we're starting to talk about the budget, all those things. It's time that this district really started to think more comprehensively in addressing our problems instead of doing a little patch job here and there and put some money to these things because our facility's aging out. I mean, it's just, it's old, it's run down, and there's leaks, there's commingling of sewage and stormwater, I would bet money, and weird stuff going on that we could be doing better. So this kind of confirms what I suspected, but you know, unless you look at it and you actually find out, you don't really know. So thank you.
So in terms of where do we go from here, that map is our recommendation that's our recommendation for how we would prioritize your next steps. Mm-hmm. And we've already met with your general manager and director of operations about how to sequence that or integrate that with some of the other things that you've got going on, you know, to make sure that you don't make a big investment in something and then have that impair your ability to address this or have to undo what you've already done. So they're on top of it. They were giving us a good education about that. And so we were kind of brainstorming with them about that. And then the other thing in terms of next steps is the budget that we're going to propose to you would be to scope the part that we couldn't get through. You know, we ran out of the money that was allocated, so I think we don't know what we're going to find there yet, and that may contribute to what you want to prioritize, and then continuing the education and outreach.
Yeah, I think the education part is so important, and I mean, it was only, I don't know how many years ago, not that long ago, that we really got it that there is a lot the public can do to help with the pet waste issue. But if the public isn't aware that that is a big part of what can lead to water pollution in the harbor, especially given the fact the harbor doesn't have a lot of circulation. Thanks, Ed. it's just that much more important. So, as new people move into the area, it's like we kind of need to keep that education going. So, could you tell us a little bit about what you guys are doing with that or want to do with that?
Yeah, I'll take a stab at that. One of the things that we've learned over the years of working with farmers and ranchers and equestrian operations and urban populations and others is that it needs to come from within the community. So a big part of it is us reaching out to people in the dog walking community and dog lovers and that sort of thing to help them, empower them to be stewards of these watersheds. So that's part of it. And then another part of it for us is sort of administrative. It sounds maybe boring to you, but all of the pots of money that we have to do outreach are restricted in very different ways. Like this one is for this creek and this one is for this problem. And in trying to bring those together so that we can be really aggressive and comprehensive in outreach and education. And then Brittany can tell you some of the specifics of the things that we are doing.
Yeah, so we have, as Kellogg said, right now we have the Petways funding focused on San Vicente Creek, which is the creek that flows to the Fitzgerald Marine Reserve. But we have been able to be a little bit flexible with that. So we've done some Petways cleanup events, and then we have also been attending events such as the dog surfing competition and like handing out brochures and things like that. So we're also going to be doing mailers, and then as we're doing that, though, it's like you have to teach people about watersheds and about water pollution in general, and then you get to pet waste. So the wet weather alerts, and actually one thing which is sending out an alert before it rains, reminding people to pick up their pet waste. One thing that I actually want to mention that we're going to do this year is Snapshot Day, which is similar to First Flush, which is a citizen science monitoring event. And we actually would like to have it at Pillar Point Harbor and make it more of an educational hub. And so we've been brainstorming things, things like that. So.
And also maybe as we plan an event that we're calling Bark in the Park, where we're gonna invite dog walkers to come out with their dogs and talk with us about taking care of water quality at the same time that they love their pets, maybe you can help us get the word out about that.
Yeah, let us know.
So have y'all worked with them? Have they talked to you about the event that they want to hold at Pillar Point?
No, not yet.
Okay. Y'all should work.
Surprise.
I think it's a great idea, so I'm just saying that y'all should work together to get this thing going.
Yeah.
So my last...
Surprise.
it sounds like you guys have a lot of great stuff planned, which is awesome. And my last comment is, I brought this up before. This is more for us versus you guys, but I know the county could play a role, or maybe they already are. I think that there's some great opportunities for educational signage for pet owners about how pet waste, not cleaning it up, it ends up in the ocean, that sort of thing. And even if somebody isn't a pet owner, they might be thinking about becoming a pet owner. And I noticed that the signs up on Pillar Point Bluff they've gotten to a point where they're so faded you can't read them anymore. And I know the county has, I thought they had a sign making machine, but maybe they don't. I had heard that county parks had one, I don't know, but they are their signs. So instead of having signage about wildlife, which I also appreciate, maybe we could do something that's a little bit more proactive and trying to educate people about what they can do to help the environment would be useful, because the signs are already there. We just need the graphics replaced. And then we could be doing more at Pillar Point Harbor to have educational signage for people, because we get such a tremendous volume of visitor traffic through our harbor, and we're getting people from all over the Bay Area and beyond. It would be a great place to educate people about why they need to clean up their pet waste in their backyard, because they may never have thought about the fact that it goes into the stormwater system. So it's something I'd love to see us work on.
Yeah, we're in a number of conversations with some of the larger landowners and land managers about signage and pet waste cleanup stations, and who would install them and who would maintain them, and how to work with community partners around that sort of thing. And so the extent to which we could partner with you on that, I think would be really great.
I think the idea of having a station and some signage together would pair, not always, but I think that would pair up well, and it would be helpful for people that don't necessarily use it, but maybe should be using it. If they understood why, they might be more inclined.
And sometimes it's not pet owners, but commercial dog walkers. Mm-hmm. And also often it's people like me who loves their dog and loves water quality, never thought about my own backyard being part of the problem until I became more educated. And so that, you know, we want to target people about cleaning up their backyard, because I think people assume proximity is part of it,
mm-hmm.
and not realizing how much the stormwater system conveys bacteria.
Yeah.
Okay. Brittany's already discussed with me funding for more signage, and I did ask her to include that in the proposal that we're presenting next month.
Excellent.
In addition, Brittany's already supplied me and my staff with a lot of educational brochures and even soft copies of educational materials that we've passed on to our tenants.
Great.
One last thing is we're going to have a Wildlife Protection Committee meeting at some point in the near future, and I'm sure that there will be quite a few folks from the dog community there. That might be a good place for you to come and just do a little bit of outreach at some point. I'll just keep you informed, and we can talk about it some other time.
Okay, Tom?
Well, you actually answered an awful lot of my questions. I was wondering, from the Harbor District point of view, do we have a provision in our leases regarding pollution, leaks, how to address violations, but I think that we've already got that on a different agenda. You've already talked to them about our strategic plan, or what I would incorporate part of the strategic plan, the capital improvement process, and I presume you're working with John or on your own as well for different grant sources. Here you've already talked about, one of my questions was, who else are you looking for funding with? GCSD, the County Stormwater Prevention Program, DFW. I get emails from DFW trying to give away money for pollution and creek cleanups all the time. But I think one of the most serious things I've got to bring up is, I've got that same little pet cleanup thing, and how did you get the dog to hold the shovel?
Are you done, Tom?
Nothing tops that one.
Robert?
You know, question. I just want to say, as always, thank you for the great work that you do, and also thank you for the very clear presentation. I mean, really, this is one of the best PowerPoints, because it's technical, but you simplify it for people like me who don't understand this stuff. It's just, it's spot on. Thank you.
I do have a public comment from James Hahn. James?
Good evening. I wasn't going to comment on this item, but because I'm not done with my analysis yet, but I'll get more into what I'm talking about in a second. But I just wanted to thank the RCD for the presentation and for their work. Commissioner Brennan brought up the idea of a more holistic approach with and incorporating this into the strategic planning process. I would request that the board and staff look into that. Right now, what I'm doing as part of one of my research projects is I sampled soils at Oyster Point Marina, and I've been testing them for not for fecal contamination or anything like that, but for elevated levels of metals of concern. And again, I have not finished the analysis yet, but I've seen elevated levels of chromium. There are different types of chromium. Hexavalent chromium is the Aaron Brockovich chemical. So the analysis I'm doing, which is X-ray fluorescence, can't break down the species of chromium, but I've seen elevated levels of total chromium. Also manganese, which is a sign of prior mining activity or maybe proximity to heavy industry. We know that OPM is a landfill that's been improperly capped. So maybe some of these materials are showing up for that reason. And for permissible levels of these metals, there's not a whole lot of information on their levels in soils. There's a lot of information on what their levels should be in drinking water. But here's a little picture I took on the day I sampled. I'm not sure if you can see it well, but those are kids playing in the soil next to the Harbor Master's office at OPM, and that's exactly where I took a couple of my samples. Also, I noticed I took samples from some areas that were kind of above the high tide line and some that were regularly inundated, and the parts that are regularly inundated are showing much lower levels of the metals I've been looking at, which indicates that they're probably leaching into the bay water. And so this might not be a concern for people who are walking by, but maybe for kayakers, recreational users, that might be a concern. I know that when I've done field work out in the bay, either in a kayak or in a wetsuit, waist deep in water, chest deep in water, if you get hit the wrong way by a random wave or the ferry wave, you can get a face full of really salty, disgusting water. So this is the thing that happens. So again, my analysis isn't complete. I may not find anything, but preliminary, the stuff I'm seeing data-wise, I want to dig into my data more and see what I'm finding. And again, so back to my original point, I would hope that even though, as this commission full well knows, many of us in the community don't believe that the Harbor District should be responsible for Oyster Point Marina, while you are, please include it in this process. Thank you.
Any last comments? I just want to thank you all for a great presentation. Thank you. Moving on to item 14. This is the mid-year budget review. Anita? Good evening, commissioners. Can you hear me? Staff report provides a detailed view of the status of the current budget at mid-year, in other words, as of December 31st, 2017. The district continues to have positive financials. Year-to-date revenues exceed expenditures by $1.5 million. As of December 31st, 2017, the district has brought in 46% of its budgeted revenues for this fiscal year, or $5.1 million. As to expenditures, the district has expended 44% of its budgeted operating expenditures and 47% of its budgeted salaries and benefits. Capital expenditures, as of December 31st, the district has only expended 2% of its capital improvements budget due to a slow start with some projects. However, it is anticipated that the district will expend at least 63%, or $4.7 million of its capital improvements budget by the end of the fiscal year. As to the impact on reserves, since the expenditures related to capital improvements will be less than budgeted, this will have a positive impact on district reserves. Reserves were budgeted at $13.4 million for this fiscal year, and since capital improvement expenditures will be under budget by $2.7 million, our reserves estimate for the end of this fiscal year is now increased to $16.1 million. First, tax revenue. The district received a deposit of $2.72 million in tax revenues as of December 31st, 2017, which is 42% of its projection. There's no action required. This is this report is informational only.
Thank you. Any questions? Comments? I do have a public comment with Games Hall.
I apologize to Commission and staff for making so many comments. I promise I'll be brief. Note that I'm apologizing directly, not to if anyone was inconvenienced. I just wanted to thank staff for the report. This is a lot more than we used to get information-wise in the past. I would like to see, and I know a lot of members of the public would like to see, some of the expenses, some of the items broken down between Pillar Point Harbor and Oyster Point Marina. Just for the board's own information, I did some quick calculations, and for capital projects, broken down, if you break it down between Oyster Point and Pillar Point Harbor, Oyster Point Marina has been allocated about 24% of the budget that goes to capital projects. And whether or not that's considered worthwhile is up to the board to decide, but I think that's information that you should have. Thank you.
So I'll make one last comment. We had a finance committee meeting yesterday, and James must have read my mind, because I've asked for that too. So I think in the future that's probably going to happen. So thanks for bringing it up.
So just one last comment on that same topic. So could we have two different pages or two different sections? How would we break up the so we can clearly see Pillar Point Harbor and OPM as far
next,
as...
Next month when we bring the preliminary budget in March, that it will be broken out. By
yeah, so that was part of the discussion yesterday because I asked for that and they said that this is... When we do the first look, then we'll get all
this,
that.
Yes, and the first look will be next month. This was just the mid-year status of the total budget.
Our Open Government link on our website also tracks things by department, so you can break it out, admin, OPM, and PPH.
Right, but I think sometimes having something in,
oh, yes. No,
in one
absolutely.
Document is
absolutely.
Just easier
it's
to
just
be.
It's just a continuous
just,
resource, but
yeah.
Absolutely bring it back as.
I also think it would be helpful if we could get information about, you know, the dates at which projects were approved by the board, so we can track, you know, projects that have been approved but haven't been completed.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, I think a lot of districts have a list, a running list like that in all of their packets, so that we as a board can track what we've approved versus what
mm-hmm.
is yet to be done, just to keep us on top of it on a regular basis.
Okay. Any other comments, Robert? We'll go to item 15, which is the 2018 goals, Steve.
Okay, yeah, thank you. On the projects, I would point commissioners and the public to item 17 on the staff report of the board package, the operations activity report, which has a fairly exhaustive rundown. It doesn't have the dates that you were requesting, Commissioner Brennan. I think we could probably easily add that to this ongoing rundown of status on the projects.
Item 17.
Item 17 of the activity reports.
Oh,
which is at the end of the agenda.
Yeah. And so I'm looking through.
Under general manager? Or?
No, under operations. And list through Pillar Point parking lot, transformers, HDOC, fishing pier repair, Romeo pier, sidewalk expansion, sea level rise assessment, West Trail, Small Tramp Dredge Project, Concentrated Timber Platform, Freshman Replacement. You know, it's fairly comprehensive, and I think it speaks to the amount that John has on his plate.
But I think it would be helpful to know, it looks like some of them have dates.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I see.
Yeah, so it shouldn't be too difficult to add some markers on them.
You know, maybe there's a way to present the information that's a little bit easier to read, too, with the dates, like, right at the top. Like, Romeo Pier demo project date of when we approved doing it.
Okay.
Like, that would be helpful.
I see John taking notes. Okay.
Great. Okay, Steve. Sorry, premature,
so,
but number of item 15.
Yeah, goals. We've started the strategic planning process, and I think we've already identified that the strategic planning process is a larger, more holistic picture. The board has already said that should be on a 10-year time frame. Goals are generally established on an annual basis. The 11 goals that I listed as suggested for approval come out of previous board actions, reports that have been issued by Mercurial AFCO, and the last time that the board approved a set of annual goals, which was in 2016. So I think I want to emphasize that the goals do not address specifically ongoing operational issues. We continue to repair and maintain. We continue to operate search and rescue. Administration continues to prepare budgets, financial reports, meet payroll, so on and so forth. Goals don't necessarily look at all of the individual prior approved capital improvement projects. But if there's something significant, we might bring it to your attention. Staff is constantly working on a number of issues. Certainly not all of the goals that were established. Commissioner Brennan, thank you. I did, as you requested, prepare, make a copy of the 2016 goals. Can you pass those down? Some of these goals have been accomplished.
Thank you.
Some are ongoing. Some are sort of removed from the list of goals as they represent more core values. Core values of quality, core values of retaining and developing staff. So in an effort to try to put some focus on some areas for this year, I did put together this brief little list of 11 items and divided them by four categories. Those that are sort of in the bailiwick of the commission, of the administration, of Piddle Point Harbor, and of Oyster Point Marina. And as you can see in commission, it's completing the strategic plan. And this was a goal established in 2016. We went through the process in 2017 of issuing an RFP, selecting a contractor, consultant, and getting that process rolling. We've already had the first workshop and a couple of conversations with our consultant this week, and we'll be coming back to the board very soon with some other dates and some next steps. One of the items brought up by President Matouche last year was the development of board policies, procedures, and this is, there is an ad hoc committee on that, and in support of that committee, developing some samples and trying to put together something that the committee could work with and then bring back to the board. And then another core responsibility for this commission is time and completion of contract negotiations with the general manager. My contract does expire November 8th, 2018. For administration, and recognizing and restating very clearly that all of these items are under the overall direction and subject to the final approval of this group. So we have to do our marching orders on contract negotiations with our two bargaining units. That is underway. That would be a core goal to complete, not just in 2018, but by the end of this fiscal year. The board previously established the Special District Leadership Foundation, District of Distinction. And this was also identified by the civil grand jury. I'm very pleased to say that a key component and a prerequisite for the District of Distinction is the Special District Leadership Foundation Transparency Certificate of Excellence. And due to the work of Debbie Garrett, over here on my right, of putting together all of the pieces and working with SDLF, we did receive notice of that Certificate of Excellence just last week, and we will be arranging with Special District Leadership Foundation to come here and make a presentation to the board of that certificate. Again, that's a prerequisite towards getting towards the District Leadership Foundation's District of Distinction Award.
So who's coming, SDLF?
It will be a representative of CSDA. SDLF is a sort of subset of CSDA,
yeah.
So the California Special District Association. We get there. Area around to come down and we'll look for a meeting that works for everybody's schedule. Get that set up.
That's going to be a special meeting?
No, we'll do that in a regular meeting. Just be a presentation.
Like a presentation.
Meeting.
Okay. I have a question about that. So I've mentioned this before. If we're going to have CSDA come to our meeting, can we also get a presentation from CSDA about the things that they're working on, not just have it be some certificate giving thing?
Just an update from CSDA on their activities, legislative advocacy, that sort of thing?
Yeah,
yeah,
so that we have, and that way we can give them feedback and there could be some discussion.
Great.
Because I'd hate to miss the opportunity.
Sounds true.
And then we could talk about, you know, some new training they might have on for 2018 or anything, you know, new that we want to.
Certainly when we put that on the agenda, I can include in the agenda, for example, the 2018 training calendar has been developed to date. Dates of things like legislative days, annual conference would be a little sort of whole deal on CSDA. Sure.
That'd be great, because I know not all the board members have gone to all their events, and they do pretty cool program.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then the other thing for administration is I'm proposing is that consistent with anything coming out of the strategic plan, we determine the permanent home from district administration. A Pillar Point Harbor.
Can I ask?
Yeah.
Should I wait till you're done and then ask?
Yeah, let's go through the report, and then we're going to open
fine.
It up for discussion and questions.
Pillar Point Harbor. As directed at the last meeting, we'll focus on the Johnson Pier Terminus, and that direction was given to us not at the last, I'm sorry, the last special meeting we had on February the 5th, and we'll start working with stakeholders on a comprehensive review and stakeholder input on the development and operation at the end of the pier. Docks F, G, and H, that process was identified by the board as a significant effort due to the condition of those docks, and I know that our director of operations has been working hard with the community and our consultant on that, moving that process forward. And the surface beach nourishment project, the sand that is accumulated on the inside of the harbor, getting that to the outside of the harbor and replenishing surface beach. We know that we've got a consultant working hard on that, but I think to make sure that that proceeds in a timely and productive manner should be a significant goal for 2018. Oyster Point Marina, I think we have plenty of discussions about the joint powers agreement and the inadequacy of the current joint powers agreement. And for the board to provide direction through the to staff and the Oyster Point committee to look at what the future of that relationship looks like, term, form of agreement, so on and so forth, so that we can move that project forward. And then also, Dock 12 is an approved project that was in the capital plan, and it's time to issue an RFP for the design, permitting, design, engineering, construction documents and permitting for that project. That would be an RFP we would issue, bring it back to the board for approval of the consultant, and then move forward from there with a similar sort of outreach to the tenants that we're doing at Pillar Point Harbor for Johnson Pier and on Docks F, G, and H. So I'm bringing this list, this short list of goals to you this evening. I know that the board is working with the consultant and staff and the public, and going to be more so in the future on the strategic plan, and it seems that this would be a good way to present to you a short list of goals, again, not inclusive by a long shot of all of the things that we're going to be doing, but a short list of goals for 2018. I think if we can pick off those 11 projects, that will be a significant accomplishment. With that, I'm happy to answer the questions.
Great. Sabrina?
Thank you. So, I don't even know where to start with this. Last time, this whole process came up, you very clearly articulated that we were going to have a stakeholder workshop to discuss goals, and we were going to get feedback from the community, and it was going to be a process. This feels like you telling us what you want the goals to be, and it does not feel like a collaborative process, and it doesn't feel like it involves the public. I mean, we have a lot of projects that haven't been done, and the fact that some are being cherry-picked and prioritized by the staff and the public and the board, and we do represent the public, that's what we were elected to do, hasn't directed this process deeply concerns me. Having said that, I have a few specifics. So with regard to this commissioner list, you've got three things here. The board handbook still hasn't happened. That's not on the list. We do need to keep updating our policies in our board, in our policy handbooks. We're not up to date. There are ways we could do that using technology that would be probably helpful. These three things are not things that I would, that come to mind as being on the top of my list of priorities. So I'll just give that feedback right now. And then as far as the administration goes, you know, I just mentioned that I think it's great that CSDA could give a more expanded presentation. And this permanent home for the district, I mean, we've never even had a meeting to discuss the priorities regarding the administrative office versus should we build new lease space so we can generate more lease revenue and the district will have more money to work with that might help fund a new administrative building. I mean, these big picture things really need to get sorted out, and to have staff, you know, kind of presenting us with their laundry list when it hasn't come through a public process, I'm really not on board with that at all. You know, I think that if you ask the public if they thought it was important whether we have a new administrative office or whether we had facilities that the public could use, such as maybe a better concessionaire's building where we could have nicer restaurant spaces with outdoor seating and decks, and you know, I can think of improved restroom facilities. I mean, there's just a lot of things we could be doing. It seems kind of out of whack, I guess would be the best way I could describe it. And I think that's because we're lacking the process that we were promised, which was a truly public process with stakeholder input to define what our goals really ought to be and keep us moving in the right direction. And as we know, we do have stakeholders with some really great ideas. So I don't know how this could get on the list without us considering administrative office space in context with all the other things that we need to do. When you divide up the two locations, Pillar Point and Oyster Point, well, I'll just take Pillar Point. You know, we just had a whole presentation on the gazillion ADA problems that we have that could lead to lawsuit and are preventing public access. So ADA, I don't see that here. And tonight we had a presentation on the fact that our infrastructure and our storm system is falling apart and possibly leaking sewage into the harbor. So that to me seems to rise to the top, along with the Johnson Pier improvements that are on here. And then Wi-Fi was approved years ago and we still don't have Wi-Fi working properly. So, you know, it's just like, how is this being determined? These are not necessarily the things that I think would benefit the public the most if we asked them, and I think we should ask them, because maybe I'm wrong. I mean, I think we ought to be looking at what the public needs and prioritizing around that. not what the general manager thinks the public needs. So as far as Oyster Point is concerned, I've said repeatedly that there is absolutely no sense in us spending any money on CIP projects at OPM because we simply do not own the facility. It's like throwing the public's money away there. And we also have a JPA, which is up in short order, and we have no idea what's going to happen with that agreement. The other thing that I'd mention is regarding the, you mentioned the Oyster Point Marina, you called it a committee. I believe that we do have a committee here, right? Like a, just with the district, we have like a, how do you define it? It's a standing committee?
Standing committee. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so there's a standing committee, just for the public to understand, an Oyster Point Marina standing committee. Then there is a joint committee of the city and the Harbor District, two members of each board. That is not a committee. That is called a group per the JPA. It's a group. And the other thing that we should be very aware of is that that group, per an amendment to the JPA, is not allowed to make any recommendations, period. They can't make recommendations to the board of either agency. So it's purely an informational gathering type of group, and it's not a group that can make recommendations, and certainly not a group that can vote on anything. So I think we need to be really clear about what's happening with that, because there seems to be a lot of confusion, and if people would just read the amendment, they would certainly better understand it. So I think that amendment should be distributed to the full board so everybody has a good hard look at it. Now, if there was another amendment, then maybe that group would be different. But based on the current amendment, it's a group that cannot vote, it cannot make recommendations. So those are just sort of off the top of my head kind of comments. I think this needs more work, and I think it's really important that our goals reflect the needs of the community. And we have some good things here. I don't want to discredit all of it. I think there's some reasonable things on here, but this, it just feels like it's coming from on high. And last time I checked, the board represents the public. The public is at the top. The board is the second tier. The management staff is the third tier, and that's essentially the general manager because that's who reports to the board. So I think we've got it kind of in reverse here, and I think as a board, we're responsible, and we need to make sure that we are working for the public. Thank you.
Thanks. Ed?
Well, you didn't leave me much to comment on. I was confused by the general form of this as well. I have to say that, as you've heard me say before, I think we need to have a public process for something like this, and we can't really set goals just unilaterally like that. Some of these are great. There are things we've talked about before, but I agree with you, Sabrina, that we need to do a little bit more work before we have something that we could really approve.
Okay, Tom?
My recollection of talking about getting a permanent home is that this was deferred to our strategic planning process outcome.
Yeah.
And our strategic plan is critical because it hasn't been updated in about 2 decades. And when we talk, a lot of this, in my opinion, is going to come out when we talk about the ADA review. That's District Goal 27 that's on this list. So we have a lot of these things covered. And it's like, well, we can sit around and talk about things, or we can let staff get on with the business day to day and make these things happen. Right now, there seems to be a permitting and a regulatory backlog that's blocking some of these things. But a presentation was made to this group to identify three places to potentially, which one should I follow up on? We said, look, let's just defer this to the strategic plan. So... I can't agree with the fact that a permanent home is important. It was important to us. We wanted to make sure that it was vetted through the public process and through the strategic plan that hasn't been updated. So we need a couple of these things to fall into place to proceed.
Hey, Robert.
Yeah, for me, I'm ready to vote on this, and I will support these district goals. I think it makes total sense, and I don't see the need to wait on them, so I'm going to support it.
Okay, I'll make a comment, and I'll take public comment. So all of these items for the 2018 goals have been, at least since the 2 years I've been on the board, been discussed in a public forum. So I'm thanks, Steve, for putting this together. I think it gives us a great place to, a direction to focus our attention, our staff's attention, but also leaves us some flexibility. So I appreciate your putting together this. I think it's a great start. We've talked about all of these issues, and it provides a focus for us to actually accomplish something in 2018. If there are no more comments from the commissioner, I do have a comment from James Hahn on this item.
Thank you to the commission. The general thrust of my comment was in line with Commissioners Brennan and Lorenz. I distinctly remember, because I was at that meeting, this discussion happening, and that public input was one of the things that was mentioned and promised. I also remember when the idea under goal number 6 of a permanent home was first brought up, multiple members of this board who normally dissent question why that was being brought up at all, when the effort to find this place was considered a big win for the district and save the district a lot of money. And it seemed to be coming out of nowhere, and it's popped up again. I just want to point out to the folks who are saying that they're ready to vote for this without any question. That's exactly what got you into trouble with the three captains hoist, and why an extra special meeting was held to reverse the vote. Commissioner Ciancarelli at least had the, despite the fact that she claimed that she was misinformed at the time or didn't have enough evidence, she at least was here to change that vote. Commissioner Bernardo was absent for that vote and was not held accountable to the public that was here at the time and made the time to be at that meeting. The board majority's willingness to rubber stamp anything staff gives them without questioning it is exactly what leads this board into trouble. So I appreciate that the board minority, Commissioners Brennan and Lorenz, are actually asking for staff to do a little more. I understand it's more work for staff. They're already taking on quite a bit, but it's something that this staff should really make an effort to do, which is to include the public and come up with a more holistic approach. Real quickly, I just wanted to mention geographic equity. I think that should be a priority of this board, especially since the current board voting majority said that that was a concern of theirs. I would like to see this board make as a priority bringing other communities in San Mateo County, giving them the opportunity to enjoy Pillow Point Harbor and Oyster Point in the way that other folks do, which usually tends to be more middle class, more white, not people from South County, not people from certain parts of North County. And it's a shame that the folks who talked about geographic equity and come from those cities aren't doing more for that. I hope this board takes it on, or that staff maybe decides to do it unilaterally. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, so the recommendation is to approve the general...
Could I make a couple of comments?
Yes, please.
Thank you. First of all, I mean, I think that the strategic plan is the sort of major thrust and effort, and in the some of the conversations I've been having with the consultant, I think that this board and the public will be very, very pleased with some of the avenues that we have been looking at for public outreach across the county. For example, in this county, the voter rolls include, or is it property tax rolls? can't remember, this is the consultant's area of expertise, include 40,000 email addresses, okay? So how can we capitalize on that to actually reach out into every corner of this county to find out what the residents of the county think? And so that's the sort of thing that we're going to be coming back to you, with to you in the near future. I want to stress again that this is not intended to be an all-encompassing list, that there are certain core values. We did go through a fairly significant exercise with the Americans with Disabilities Act. We have a transition plan, we have identified projects, and we are implementing that plan. Accessibility for all is has been prioritized by this board as a core value. And so, again, this list was not intended to be exhaustive. The comments about the permanent Hartford District Administration, I think, like on the in the narrative, I mean, the very first four words there are consistent with the strategic plan. The strategic plan guides all of this. This is all coming forward consistent with previous board direction. In 2017, we got to April of talking about goals and objectives for 2017 without reaching consensus on anything. We did discuss having a board workshop, but what happened instead was that we transitioned into, I think it was actually advertised as goals at that strategic planning workshop on January the 24th. We didn't get to specific goals, but that's how it was advertised. And if I remember correctly, we had just a couple of members of the public attending that meeting. So I'm quite open to, I mean, I'm not, please give me feedback. Please don't rubber stamp anything that I put in front of you. It's February, I'm trying to move forward with establishing a short, concise set of goals that I can hang out there in graphic form to guide my actions, independent upon of the separate direction that this board gives me and my staff on a monthly basis. That will keep going on. Those projects will keep moving forward. Nothing falls by, well, nothing. We don't stop doing other projects because they're not on this brief list. This is an idea to try to establish something to, in very broad brushstrokes, to keep us moving forward, again, consistent with the broad direction that we get through the strategic planning process, which we wrapped up in a few months. We'll be wrapping up. We'll be back to you in March on that.
I'd like to make a motion to approve General Manager's recommendation of 11 goals for 2018.
I had a couple comments.
Okay, please. Well, let's get a second and then we can continue the discussion.
Second.
Okay, Sabrina, discussion. Let's continue the discussion.
Thank you. So first of all, I just want to say that I recall very, very distinctly having conversation meeting with the general manager where we were talking about important work that needs to be done that could put the district in jeopardy of a lawsuit. And I was told that it's not on the list of goals, so therefore it's not my priority. I'm just saying that I've been told that, so that's why I'm very concerned about things that don't get on the list of goals not being prioritized. And I felt like I was getting some attitude. And, you know, I know there's a lot to juggle. I realize that this is difficult and we don't have a huge staff, so I totally get that. But when something falls off the list of goals, I'm afraid that then it's not going to be a priority for the general manager based on the communication I've heard in the past. So that's what worries me, and that's why I'm making a point of this. Secondly, with regard to the email addresses included in the voter roll, those email addresses are not for use for anything other than
maybe it was property tax.
Political campaigns.
I don't recall the detail, and I apologize for actually specifying something without being sure of what I was
saying. Okay, because that would be illegal for us.
Okay, yeah, well, certainly we're not going to do anything
illegal. I hope not. Okay,
no,
good.
Definitely not.
So those email addresses can only be used specifically for campaign materials for elections. As far as the point the public made about geographic equity and access, I couldn't agree more. I think, you know, one of our top priorities ought to be, what are we doing for access? What's going on with our segment of the coastal trail that's a complete mess through Pillar Point Harbor? I mean, why haven't we done anything to improve it? And educational signage, you know, we talked about that earlier. That's key for getting the public to learn about ways to protect our environment, and particularly our marine environment. That is really key. And so now that's not on the list. Wi-Fi, we already approved it. The public expects us to have it. It's not functioning properly, and certainly not at OPM. Infrastructure, you know, it's falling apart at Pillar Point Harbor. ADA access is so critical. You know, I can't believe we haven't been sued yet. I mean, especially now that we've got this comprehensive list itemizing the gazillion ADA violations, which should be published online. Is it online yet?
I believe it is.
Okay, great. Could you send me a link for that, Debbie? That'd be awesome. So, you know, what are we doing? Like, we're not putting ADA on the list when we know we're ripe for a lawsuit? That doesn't make sense to me.
First of all, I would contest the idea that we're ripe for a lawsuit. I think that when I first brought up the idea of the ADA transition plan and retaining a consultant, it was out of an awareness of liability, and that the first step is to identify all of the issues. We've got a very comprehensive list now, and as I just said, I think ADA and accessibility is a core value, and we are working on those projects. Certainly, the RCD presentation this evening and conversations that John and I had with Brittany and Kellex before this presentation gave us pause around some of the projects, because we recognize that we've got collapsing stormwater lines. So that's got something that has to be addressed. Again, there are so many things that continue to be done that, I mean, we could make a list of 70 items. I mean,
I think we kind of need to do that, Steve, because otherwise, how are we going to think through?
Well,
if you do one thing and then you have something else that needs to be done, you've got to think about the order in which you do things.
Yes.
And so if we don't have a complete picture, then we're making decisions without a complete picture, and that leads to wasting money.
So I'd like to make a comment.
Please. Okay. Sabrina, are you done?
Yeah, thank you.
Thanks. Ed?
So one of the aspects of this that bothers me, and one reason I don't want to vote for this, is because maybe it's just a language on the document, and that is just, you know, the first thing we read, recommended motion, approved general manager's recommendation of the 11 goals for 2018. When I read that, I thought, there's 11 goals for 2018, and we're going to approve 11 goals for you for 2018. That didn't make a whole lot of sense to me. And then in this aspect of the document where you line item them, you have a description of the goal and then some characterization of where we are in that process. And it's kind of confounding. But also, as you mentioned, Sabrina, and you did too, there's a lot of goals that are on this several pieces of paper that we have. Some have been prioritized, others haven't, and some were prioritized a long time ago. And so I'm still confused, and maybe those of you that recommended this, that we pass this motion, can explain it to me, or maybe you can, is what is this actually about? I mean, do you understand my question?
Yes, I
don't understand it.
I absolutely do, and I think that's actually not the question. Trying to focus our conversation. conversation will be. I mean, I think that question, you know, is absolutely on point. The idea that we can list everything that needs to get done as a set of goals doesn't sort of belies the professionalism of the staff that mm-hmm. you've got to operationally manage the district under the broad policy and governance direction of the board. We brought to you, and I'll go back to the ADA thing, we brought to you the idea mm-hmm. of an ADA transition plan.
Yeah.
We did an RFP. We brought to you approval of a contract with a consultant. And then we developed that ADA transition plan. And as a result of that, we now know the status of our facilities. And we can, through that, start working on remediating those things. If we're going to touch something, we go back to that report. We say, well, if we're going to touch this, is a portion of this addressed in the ADA report? Yes, it is. Well, we'll pull it in. Or we will look at some of the low-hanging fruit and start picking away at it. We'll recognize the significant issues and prioritize those. I'm not sure how long ago it was that your director of operations brought a proposal from an architect to start working on ADA access to the Harbor Masters building at Pillar Point. That's us moving forward with operational implementation of a plan that the board has approved.
Right. I get all of that.
Steve. Okay.
I understand that, but what I don't understand is what is it that we're doing? You're asking us to approve 11 goals. Is that something that is going to... I mean, I understand the idea to have a series of goals that you can tell the public that this is what I'm working on. You just described a bunch of them.
Mm-hmm.
But approving 7, what seems to me to be maybe summaries or high level goals. I don't see the value in that or why we're being asked to prove this. It's not something. You see what I'm saying?
I mean, like I said before, I do believe
that we need to go through iterative processes with the public where we with staff and others talk about how we prioritize these goals, public input, all that. But this is is a document that once we seal the approval, we now have said these are the 11 goals. It doesn't make sense to me.
We could
discuss it some other time. Yeah, just giving you my perspective.
I removed the what is the grammatical term, the pronoun, the prefix the. These are 11 goals, not the 11 goals. These are 11 goals. I said, you know, there's so much more
right.
that we're doing.
Right.
But I'm sort of, some of these are sort of up here as opposed to higher elevation, as opposed to down here. And this stuff is the stuff that we bring you on a monthly basis, right?
Mm-hmm.
On a monthly basis, going forward, approve an RFP. We've got a couple of them for you in March. You know? Those keep coming forward. And that's us just operating the district under your board guidance. So the idea of these is that these were sort of higher elevation.
I have a follow-up question. Are you still?
No.
Here?
I'm not kidding.
Okay, Sabrina.
So,
I'm sorry, Ed.
That's all right.
You know, I agree with Ed's point that this feels really arbitrary, and this whole process, it has the feeling of something that's like you're trying to put a smiley face on things to say we checked this off, we did this. It's sort of insignificant. I don't know what it really means. You know, are we just going to prioritize things on this list? You've told me in the past that's what you do, yet there are other things that are of even more priority that didn't, you know, are equal to some of the others that didn't make it onto the list. The whole thing just seems like a waste of time to me. So that's my point of view on it. And as far as ADA goes, the comments you made about ADA, which I've heard you say in the past, lead me to believe that you feel that by doing a study of the gazillion ADA liabilities and significant access problems, we have again put a smiley face on it, and we're not actually going to come up with a comprehensive plan for fixing those things. We're just going to patchwork it, piecemeal it as we go. And I know that's how we do things here. I'm familiar with the process. But what I'm saying is, why aren't we looking at a comprehensive plan to fix it all? Like, and then we could take it area by area. Why are we doing this patch job? I'm really upset about this patch job. It has been going on for decades. It's throwing money away. The whole thing is falling apart from top to bottom. We need to come up with a comprehensive plan, which we don't have.
Please.
It requires hiring the right consultants, going through a public process, and literally renovating the whole Pillar Point Harbor. And there are firms that do that. And we're not, you know, this is just more patchwork stuff. And it's just frustrating. It's, you know, I'm sorry if I sound really annoyed, but I mean, it's been 5 years that I've been on this board, and it's every year, it's the same old thing, where we're just going to Frankenstein it, patchwork it, put a smiley face on it, keep going. Nothing ever really gets done. The list of projects we've already approved that there's been no momentum on is long. You know, and why is that? Because we're not thinking comprehensively, and we're not, obviously, yes, if the pipes are all broken, you got to start with what's underground first, and then you've got to build up. You know, I mean, it just seems like we're not really tackling this in a way that's going to get us there. So I'm just voicing a little frustration about that. Thank you.
I'd like to call the question if there aren't any more questions.
There's been a call for the question. And no more public comment. So let's take a vote.
Commissioner Mattush?
Aye.
Commissioner Lorenz?
No.
President Ciancarelli?
Aye.
Commissioner Brennan?
No.
Commissioner Bernardo?
Aye.
The motion carries 3-2. Item 16, committee review and assignments. So, Steve, I know you wrote this report, so if you want to kind of kick it off.
President Ciancarelli, this is yours, I bet.
Yeah. No, I know, but I mean, because you wrote it, so I didn't know if you wanted to add a comment, because I have...
You know, for the benefit of the public, I will mention that at the last regular meeting, you did appoint yourself and Commissioner Mattush to the Finance Committee. The other... committees remain populated as they were last year, but generally speaking, it's the prerogative of the president at the beginning of their term to populate or repopulate committees.
Okay. I have a public comment from James Vaughn on this item that I'll take.
It'll take me a second to get there. My leg fell asleep. It's pretty bad.
What? His leg fell asleep.
Oh, yeah. Dear.
So.
Okay. That's a wake-up call. Okay, so thank you for taking my comment. I just wanted to respectfully ask that you appoint people to these committees fairly. And with consideration as to what the expertise you all hold actually is. I'm a little concerned that for the Climate Change Committee, it says each committee, so every committee is assisted by staff in some way, and so the Climate Change Committee is assisted by operations, at least according to the staff report. I'd like to know if staff is considered looking into a science advisor. That would be really helpful. I know Commissioner Lorenz is really well-versed on a lot of things, but I think it would benefit the entire district to look into getting an actual science advisor.
I would respectfully ask, too, that folks who voted against a presentation on sea level rise, flooding concerns, king tide concerns at Oyster Point Marina should not be appointed to the Climate Change Committee. That includes Commissioners Chancarali, Commissioners Matouche, Commissioner Bernardo. The three of you voted to table a presentation by Commissioner Brennan on safety issues, climate change issues, sea level rise issues, at a meeting at South San Francisco, where it would have been quite salient to hear. I was at that meeting an hour early, and I saw as staff scrambled around to get that presentation ready. And as I said that night, I thought it was very disrespectful that after all the work they put in, we just tabled the item. So again, please make sure that appointments are done fairly and not in a retaliatory manner as they have been in the past, under the past precedent. Thank you.
Great, so what I'm am recommending, besides keeping Tom and me on the Finance Committee, is putting Robert and keeping Tom on the Oyster Point Committee. For the Climate Change Resiliency Committee, I'd like to put Ed and myself on there. We kind of talked about that a little bit. Mm-hmm. Wildlife Protection, I think it's a great new committee, and I think it's very exciting. I think Ed and Sabrina are very passionate about that, so I'd like to put them on there. And for strategic planning, I'd like to put Robert and Tom, mainly because there's a coast side presence and a bayside presence. I've done my best, I think, to do things fairly, and also trying to match interests and trying to be respectful of time commitments. So those are what I would recommend. I'm open to suggestions, but I'm pretty much gonna, you know, I'd love to hear what you have to say, but I think this is the best way to, these committees are going to be populated in the best way possible.
Can you go over that one more time?
Sure. Yeah. Oyster Point would be Robert and Tom. Finance, as Steve McGraw said last month, I appointed myself and Tom. The Climate Change Committee would be Ed and me, because I was on the Beach Replenishment Committee my first year on the board. The Wildlife Protection, which is a new committee, would be Ed and Sabrina. And Strategic Planning, and I don't even know how active that would be, because that's an ad hoc committee. We've taken significant steps in dealing with the strategic plan, but just in case, Tom and Robert.
Yeah, I have
And that's an ad hoc committee, strategic plan. Okay, Sabrina?
I have a comment. So, Commissioner Matouche, in an act of retaliation, removed me from all committees. And so currently, the only committee that I'm technically on is an ad hoc committee, which is the Strategic Planning Committee, which has had a total of one meeting in as long as I can remember. So like a year or more. And from what I'm hearing, Commissioner Matouche is now going to be on three committees. Is that accurate?
One, two. Well, the ad hoc is, I really don't anticipate that meeting that much.
So that's
all.
Three committees.
No, two standing committees. And
two,
the ad hoc.
Two standing plus an ad hoc.
But the ad hoc, like I said, we've gone through the strategic planning process. So I think that's, I don't even know if there would even be a need to meet, but
so,
just in case as a backup.
So two standing, one ad hoc. Then we've got Lorenas on two committees. And we've got Chancarali on two committees. We've got Brennan on one committee. And we've got Bernardo on one committee.
No, he's on an ad hoc committee as well.
Oh, sorry, two committees. Okay. Two committees. All right, so everybody's on two committees or more, except for Commissioner Brennan, who hasn't been on any committees after Commissioner Matouche's retaliation. And Commissioner Matouche admitted to everyone tonight and to the television audience that he sent pornographic email to me and I guess 41 other people, and I hear including one other woman.
So that was off topic, and we're going to go get to that item, or your that concern, or your item.
It's important to me.
17.
It is important to me to bring up the fact that you would put somebody who sent pornographic images to me on three committees.
Thank you for your opinion, Robert.
I am holding you accountable for that, President Corrali.
Robert?
Yes, thank you. since I'm going to be on the Oyster Point Committee, I'd like to do a swap. Can I not be on the beach replenishment?
You're not. Ed and I are.
Okay, because I'm looking at this.
That's been a change.
Oh, I'm so sorry. Is this... Oh, I'm
that's
looking...
That's the old one.
Never mind.
So there's the Climate Change Committee.
Okay, sorry for the confusion. We're good.
Okay. Any other comments?
Yeah, I have a comment.
Okay.
I do not want to serve on...
Wildlife Protection?
No, I do not want to serve on that committee. And I also don't want to have a committee position used against me. This has happened in the past, so I need to speak my point without interruption, please. It has been used against me in the past to try to manipulate me by the board president, and I am not going to stand for it. I do not want to be part of this. This is pathetic. I am disgusted with what is happening here, and I would rather not serve on a committee than be part of what is happening with this board right now.
Okay.
The fact that Commissioner Mattouche is being rewarded by being put on three committees after what he did is appalling.
Thank you for your opinion. The Wildlife Protection Committee, I thought, would be of interest to you since you voted for it. When we made this a standing committee, I thought it would be an exciting new committee for you and Ed to serve on, but thank you for letting me know that you would like to take yourself off of that. I want to make it clear for the public that this is not retaliation. So I don't work that way. I'm sorry that Commissioner Brennan thinks and feels that way, but that is not the case at all. So if anyone else would like to be on the Wildlife Protection Committee, I mean, I could be on it with you, Ed, because it kind of can go hand in hand with the climate change. I'm happy to do it so that at least we can meet, because I think it could be a very interesting committee, especially in light of the RCD report. Okay, so I'll put myself on the Wildlife Protection Committee. And for the record, Commissioner Brennan took herself off of a committee, so she's no longer on any committee. So moving on to item 17.
One last comment, if I may. I'm not requesting to be on another committee, just to be clear. But I do want to comment that if you've been a close observer of this commission, when we've taken up finance or issues surrounding Oyster Point, I've been a dissenting voice for the district with respect to my three commissioners to my left, so Robert, Tom, and Virginia. And now we have finance and Oyster Point Marina with no real dissenting voices. This is just a comment for you.
Okay.
Because.
Great, thank you. Okay, Commissioner Items, item 17, sexual harassment, gender discrimination, and retaliation prevention and response. This was put on the agenda by Commissioner Brennan, and per our policies, staff has not put any work into this except to provide the current policy. That we are operating under right now. So, Sabrina?
Thank you. Because of the fact that very frequently the items that I put on the agenda are actually not heard by this board, and because the board ends the meeting before we complete our board agenda and our board packet, I have taken up the habit recently of communicating whatever I need to communicate during commissioner comments at the beginning of the meeting, because likelihood is that we'll never get to an agenda item that I put on the agenda. And since the general manager has chosen to have items that aren't heard roll off and never be heard again unless you bring them back as your one and only agenda item the next time there's a meeting, it's really difficult. It's a really difficult situation. And so most of what I had to say about this item, I said at the beginning of the meeting, which was I read my letter to the board.
And that's a public document.
And that's a public document, and Debbie is going to be attaching that to the website so people will be able to see it there. A video of that comment is on YouTube, and that can also be found on my website, which is sabrinabrennan.com. Under the section journal, so if you click on journal, you'll see it. There's so much I could say about what has happened with this investigation process and the fact that it has lacked any reasonable pretense of independence, objectivity. It's absolutely biased. It was overseen by an attorney who I have actively suggested that we replace. In the past, when there's been investigations at this district, the general manager, not this general manager, but the one before, oversaw the investigation when he was the person who perpetrated the harassment. That's the kind of stuff that goes on here when you have the people who actually are doing bad things overseeing the investigation. It's pretty messed up. So I'm not going to dwell too much on the past, but I would like to say that the apology that we heard this evening, if we could even call it an apology, was incredibly disrespectful. It wasn't an apology to me. I'm not sure what that was about, but it definitely was not something that I consider an apology. The statement that Commissioner Matouche and I are good friends, I've heard that before. In fact, that was in the investigation report. He claims that we're good friends. We are not good friends. We have never been good friends, and I just want to make it clear that I have never considered Commissioner Matouche one of my good friends. So I'd just like to state that, make it clear that he, in his mind, may think of me as a good friend, but that is not how I think of him.
Okay.
I confronted him after he sent the email, and he said it was just a joke. And he said that I didn't get a sense of humor.
Yes.
I also confronted him before he sent the email. I confronted him when he invited me on a trip paid for by him to Tanzania, Africa, to go on a safari to hunt big game. I confronted him about the fact that we're married. And I asked him, did you tell your wife that you're inviting me on this trip? And he said, no, why would I do that? That is what he said to me. So, you know, I just want to make sure everybody's clear on what happened, because Commissioner Matouche has not been telling the truth. He lied at our last board meeting. He claimed that he did not send the email and that I was lying. And then tonight he admitted that he did it. So this person is not trustworthy. He has breached the public trust. There's so much wrong with this. I mean, I don't even know where to start. On page 9 of the investigation, Matouche denied.
Hold on. We're getting here. This is still under attorney-client privilege.
This is
under attorney-client privilege. So.
I'm not done yet. So I will change. I will change what I was
going
to say.
You are breaching attorney-client privilege.
I am not
reading from the report.
I am not reading from the report.
You just said
on page
9.
I am telling you from memory.
So, if someone would like to waive attorney-client privilege as to the report,
I move that we make the report public.
Great. I will second that. Or you
You want to second that?
I'll second that.
Okay. So now we have a discussion about the report.
Wait, are we voting or?
Oh, I'm sorry.
Roll call vote?
Roll call. I'm sorry. So to be clear, Debbie.
Wait, could you just clarify what it is that you're.
We are waiving attorney-client privilege as to the report. So that we can actually have a discussion so that this commission.
I'm sorry, to the what?
The investigator's report. Investigator's final report, which we did not receive in time for the agenda, by the way. So that's the motion made by Sabrina and seconded by Tom.
And I want to make it clear that it is not to be redacted. The full report needs to be released.
I agree. So continue. So if you'd like to. So.
Let's have a vote. Please, I call.
So wait, I'm sorry, did you want
Let's
to say
vote.
Something, Steve Miller?
Roll call.
If you would like to go ahead and vote.
Let's
and
vote.
If you would like to hear what I have to say, that's fine. Otherwise, you can
I would
vote.
Like to vote.
Well, there's a motion and a second.
Can you please call?
I'm managing this meeting. Let me finish. So we have a motion and a second. So we're going to do a roll call to waive the attorney-client privilege for the final report of the investigator. Roll call, please, Debbie.
Commissioner Brennan?
Aye.
Commissioner Mattouche?
Aye.
Commissioner Lorenz?
Aye.
Commissioner Bernardo?
Aye.
President Ciancarelli?
Aye. So the motion carries. So, Steve Miller?
Well, it's not clear to me whether your motion was to waive the report in a completely unredacted fashion or not.
We didn't redact it.
It would be, what's that?
We did not redact it.
In its entirety.
Okay. Then there's no point in my saying what I was going to say.
Okay. Go ahead. Okay. So now you can
thank you.
Read from it without breaching attorney-client privilege.
So I'm not reading from it.
Or citing it, whatever. Citing
on page 9 of the report, Mattouche denied ever talking to Brennan about sex or lesbian sex. He denied that it ever came up in conversation or that Brennan ever talked about these subjects. That he ever talked to Brennan about these subjects. That is completely untrue. Commissioner Mattouche is obsessed with talking about sex and lesbian sex and has done it on multiple occasions. And I'm happy to talk to anybody who's interested in more detail about how that has happened. Page 6, investigators did not contact any of the women and men who were, other than me, who were included on the distribution list of the pornographic email. There are other things the investigator neglected to do, but that's the one that I'll highlight right now. I'm not in full agreement with what's in the report. There are things that are incorrect. I'm speaking on my end of it. I have audio recordings of both interviews that I did with the investigator. So I know what was said and it's in the recordings. With regard to page 7, Mattouche stated that he believed Brennan would think the email was funny because she's a lesbian and that the two of them had prior conversations about Brennan being out. Mattouche recalled that Brennan told him after receiving the email that she received these kinds of emails from her lesbian friends all the time, he said. He said, I receive these kind of emails from my lesbian friends all the time. Now, who would believe that? That is a complete lie. None of my lesbian friends send me pornographic email. None of them. He said that she seemed blasé about it in general. Wow. You know, after reading the report, I realized that in addition to sexual harassment and retaliation, I was also dealing with sexual orientation discrimination.
And I should have mentioned that also. But I mean, at some point, there's just so much harassment. Which term are you going to pick? Does it even matter anymore? I don't know. But I feel after reading this and the comments that Commissioner Matouche included, that he is homophobic, and that that may have fueled some of the harassment that I had to deal with. And I am disgusted with his behavior. Disgusted.
Tom?
Thank you.
I don't feel I should dignify Commissioner Brennan's comments other than to say she's an incredibly prolific liar, and there's virtually nothing that occurred in the report that was transcribed as I recall it. Now, I don't know if she's just a plain liar or if there's she's under some type of stress and it has a problem remembering things.
Robert, do you have any comment?
I have no comment.
Okay, Ed? Okay, so I wanted to just clear, I wanted our general counsel to walk us through the process and how the neutral investigator was picked, because I asked that question, and I think it's only fair to our legal counsel, who's actually worked pretty hard in general on behalf of the district, but specifically tried to minimize his involvement with this. So Steve, if you wouldn't mind, just for the public record, stating the process that you used and worked with the general manager.
I'd be happy to. I didn't work for the general manager, but I'll be happy to.
Okay.
So the district has a policy that it adopted in 2016.
Worked with, I didn't say worked.
I see. that policy, in my view, is in keeping with EEOC best practices and compliance with all legal requirements, and goes considerably beyond those legal requirements. And among other things, it calls for when there's a complaint against either a commissioner or the general manager, calls for the general counsel to initiate and authorize a independent outside investigation. Someone has to recommend who the investigator is, and your policy gives that role to the general counsel. I think the reason for that, while I don't think it was explicitly stated by the board when it adopted that policy, but the reason that is that the general counsel's job is to advise the district as to what the law is and whether there have been any violations of law. You want an outside investigator to do a fact-finding investigation, but you generally want your counsel to advise you on the legal obligations of the entity. So what I did when a complaint that triggered that obligation, the policy was, occurred, is I, based on my own just knowledge and experience, but more heavily relying on an organization called the Association of Workplace Investigators, which is, as far as I'm concerned, the gold standard trade organization for workplace investigators, I spoke to a couple of potential sustaining members of that organization, and then checked their bios, solicited some references, and arrived at a woman named Mary Topliff, whom I had never met before, who had never had any contact with the commission before or with the Harbor District, and seemed to me to have great integrity, great resume, great credentials, and the necessary independence. And so I recommended that the district engage her because her fee that she quoted was within the authority, contracting authority, delegated to the general manager. The general manager then, on behalf of the district, entered into a contract with her. She received a letter from my office with a copy of the written complaint from Commissioner Brennan, as well as the media reports that existed at the time, and a request to investigate those allegations, along with a statement that she had freedom to conduct the investigation in any way she saw fit without interference or direction from my office. She chose the witnesses she wanted to interview. She chose the nature and the course of the investigation. I then, after that one preliminary conversation, and then gave her Steve McGraw's email for the contract, I did not speak to her again. She had a couple of what I gather were process questions about like how to contact certain people, and there was a lawyer in the employment section at my law firm who also has never worked in the Harbor District, who was her point of contact to answer those sorts of procedural questions. The next I heard from the investigator was a day before the report was submitted, which I want to say was on Tuesday of last week, I believe. So Monday of last week, she called and said she's completed her investigation, and we chatted for a few minutes about, again, you know, how she was going to submit it and where she was going to submit it to, but again, did not instruct her in any way as to what conclusions to reach, did not review a draft of the agreement. I just received the final agreement, the final report in the form that was submitted to me that some of you have seen and that you now have decided to waive the privilege to. It is a privileged document, or was a privileged communication. And a lot of these rules, well, I'll end there. I think that describes the process and the nature of my investigation, my relationship with this woman, who to this day I have not yet met or no plans to meet.
Okay, I'm going to take public comment. I have two public comment cards, James Hahn.
Good evening. Before I get into my intended comments, I just wanted to read the definition of gaslighting. Gaslighting is manipulating someone by psychological means into questioning their own sanity. When Commissioner Mathieu said that, oh, Sabrina Brennan is just hysterical, she's under stress, this is a classic, excuse my language, dick move that men use to marginalize women. My mother is a survivor of domestic violence. I grew up with police coming around to my house on multiple occasions. When she would say stuff to the police, my dad would say, don't listen to her, she's had a tough day, she's exaggerating, she's under a lot of stress. Listening to that from you, the abusive nature of what you do as an elected member of this board is just shameful. Now, to my original comment, I appreciate what General Counsel had to say about this process and the effort that was taken to make it objective, but end of story. If the alleged, now confirmed, victim of sexual harassment is saying they're not comfortable with the process, it's not a good process. I'm sorry, that's the end of story. As much as people have disagreements on this board, you know well enough that if staff made a good faith effort to find a law firm and an attorney that both Commissioners Brennan and Mathieu were comfortable with, that would have happened. There was no reason for all this drama, for meeting after meeting of Commissioner Brennan saying in public, out loud, I'm not comfortable with this process. I want to see something different. There shouldn't have had to have been all this drama to have had this report go public. End of story. If the victim is not comfortable with your process, you have done a poor job. I want you to keep that in mind. Real quickly, Tom, when Commissioner Nicole David was still on this board and Glenn Lazoff was still a member of this board, Sean Cartwright, Sabrina, and I ran into you flaming drunk at San Benito House after a board meeting here. Glenn Lazoff was also flaming drunk and he fell off the step of the front door as he was walking out. I don't think you're in any position to question people's recall or integrity. Thank you.
Thank you, John Olin.
I'm a little bit confused about what actually was an investigation and then she came to the conclusions, or did she just get the facts and present it to you and then somebody made a decision? So that's not real clear to me from what you said. And the idea that you didn't get the investigation in time for tonight's meeting to get on the agenda has pretty much been blown out of the water since you told us you had it last Tuesday, it was done. So it could have easily been put on this agenda. Everybody here knows it. You tried to put it, stuff it out so it happened in 30 days, maybe. and then by then it wouldn't be news anymore. It's very clever, ploy, works all the time, it's hardly original. That's what you're doing. Now, I'm trying to understand if this process is fair, why it is that Mr. Matouche is quoting from a letter that Mr. Miller sent to, I believe, Mr. Matouche's attorney, saying that he's been, that nothing in the investigation sustains any of the allegations. How could that be? Was that attorney-client privilege? Because if she had said it, if she had resolved, had done something that was revealed attorney-client privilege, someone would be banging the gavel right now. Someone would be having a fit. Somebody would be making threats. But that's not what happened. A man made those allegations. A man says, basically, tonight's example, our president, he could have quoted our president, she's bleeding out of her whatever. And that's why she's not able to make coherent accusations. He doesn't have the story straight and is a liar. This guy sat there, Mr. Matouche sat there last week or 2 weeks ago and said that everything that she said was a lie. He told Robert Honda of NBC News that there were absolutely no photographs sent and that he never invited her. So as board president, he's gone out there and basically lied. And there's no consequences for it. But if she does something like that, there will be definitely consequences. Not one of you can look up at me. Do you not get it? You're playing good old boy favorites. If you'd all just played this game right, if you'd had it on tonight's agenda, if you'd just gone straight about it, this would have been over hours ago. But that's not what you wanted. That's not what he wanted. He definitely is very uncomfortable that any of this was released. He tried his best to stop you from doing it.
Thank you. I'm gonna make my comment, and then I wanna try to finish and get through an entire agenda. I actually read the report, actually from a very detached manner, because I, you know, I'm trying to be as neutral as possible. And there's no doubt that Tom doesn't have clean hands, but at the same time, and I'm not defending Tom, but I don't appreciate the photograph, he wasn't in elected office. This harbor district policy does not cover anyone. Please be respectful of people.
No, I can't be respectful when you say dumb things like that.
Well,
that's
your opinion. So anyway, please, you've already had your say. So it's my turn to speak.
Go for it.
So the policy in place for 2016 was complied with. What is actually troubling to me is that the investigator found the allegations by Commissioner Brennan unfounded, and this is a classic case of he said, she said, and I don't even know what to make of that. But I will say this is my parting words. The Harbor District takes sexual harassment and retaliation allegations very seriously. We do. And this is not the time to make a mockery of a movement that is very serious, that affects men and women. And I feel like this is what has happened. And that is all I have to say. It's just unfortunate that we are now in this position. I'm going to make one final motion, which is to waive attorney-client privilege for a release of the summary of the attorney's fees, the charges that have been incurred on this, the investigation.
Question on the motion?
Sure.
Specifically, can you be more specific on what you just said about the attorney's fees?
I think there's a summarization of the bill.
Of this whole
for
thing.
This specific investigation.
Okay.
And this is the tax money that the public has entrusted us to watch over. This is their report. And by the way, members of the public are not confined to this room. This has been in the news, and the public deserves to know about this report, which is the reason I supported putting this out in the public, and the public deserves to know how much it has cost them. So I have made this motion to release or waive the privilege, attorney-client privilege, to release the summary, not the itemization, the summary of our the cost of this investigation.
Second.
Okay.
Why not the whole itemization?
Because I think it's just easier for the summary. So, any last discussions on that?
I have comments on this topic. Yeah.
On which topic? The report or my motion?
I have more comments to make on this item.
We have 15 minutes and we have to go through the rest of the consent calendar. So you can either make your comments. I think you've made a lot of them. I'm not going to stop you. But we can extend the time, but I'm telling you, we've been here since 5:30.
I'm going to vote on the motion, though.
Right. As to the consent calendar, the only one that we really need to pass this evening is number one, bills and claims.
Okay.
So first I'd like to say that we're discussing.
Oh, this is part of that? Okay.
Well, are you discussing the motion? Because we're discussing the motion on the table right now.
It's all under one item.
I would like to make another comment.
On the motion?
I would like to make another comment
on the item. Then let's vote on the motion first, then you can make your comment.
That's totally inappropriate.
Nope, you can
You're
make a comment on...
Me.
I am not trying
you
to silence...
You are trying to silence me.
I'm going to take a 5-minute break.
Literally with a gavel.
Okay, take a 5-minute break then. Great idea.
Do you have an extra copy of the report? I'd like to take a look at
it. Yeah, can we have it?
I do have it.
So I'd like to consult with the general manager, make sure that it's released in a manner that's equitable to the public and to each commissioner. I don't have 30 copies of it to distribute to
everyone. Well, we didn't think we'd be waiting
to turn
so
it I'll set up online tonight. It'll be out there for everybody to see.
Not with me tonight that I can do something with, but I hear you loud and clear. I'm certainly not trying to stop the distribution. I just can't do it this evening.
During the break, I would like to read it. So if I could borrow it, that'd be great.
You mean just right now for 5 minutes? Is that what you mean?
Yes, right now for 5 minutes.
Yeah, sure.
Think about it.
Yeah, we don't have a quorum yet, Steve. Sorry. We would have to wait.
Claire, as well as Wayne, could you send me a link to the report or forward me a copy and I'll put it up on for
Send me an email.
You got it.
Okay. What the hell?
Convening at 9:23, we have a motion on the table. And if you would like to have discussion on the current motion, Sabrina, I would. That's fine. But otherwise, we're going to do a vote on the motion.
I don't have a problem with the motion, although I would suggest that we make all the financials available.
You can make that motion.
So I would like to make an friendly amendment that we expand the breadth of what we're providing to the public as far as the costs of legal for this investigation to include the detailed invoices. So that's what I think we should release. I don't think there's any reason to do a summary.
And you can either accept the friendly amendment or not accept it, Robert?
Commissioner Giancarlo, you made the motion.
Yeah, you, I seconded it.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. I am not going to accept that amendment.
Okay.
So there's a motion,
and I'm not done yet.
If
I'm
you're
almost...
like to talk about this motion, then you may. But otherwise,
I know.
So, are you going to talk about my motion?
When you said that there was a mockery of a movement,
no.
were you talking about Tom?
We're going to do a roll call because the discussion is ended.
Or were you talking
so
about?
We're going to do
you
a roll
talking
call.
About
we're
yourself.
Going to do a roll call. Thank you,
Commissioner Lorenz.
Aye.
President Ciancarelli.
Aye.
Commissioner Bernardo.
Aye.
Commissioner Brennan.
Aye.
Commissioner Matouche.
Aye.
That motion passes unanimously. We are going to go to the consent calendar, item one, bills and claims, because that apparently has to be passed so that we can actually make payment. Sabrina, you pulled this off, so let's talk about that, please. Or please open up with your reason for pulling it off.
I'm getting to it. Yeah. Okay, so I just wanted to point out for the public two things on our bills and claims. We have a bill, or let's just call it an invoice, from GHD, which is the consultant that is responsible for the West Shoreline Trail project, for $20,170.94. We continue to stack up costs for that project. Any idea when that's going to be completed? No.
No. Okay. We're currently working with the consultant to meet all of the permitting requirements. I just met with them out there on Wednesday of last week, actually at the site, as they're trying to meet the California Coastal Commission's CDP requirements.
Thank you. And then the second one is a invoice from Hanson Bridget for $21,259.50. So my question is, does this include costs for Mary Topliff, or is she billing us directly?
It does not. She has a separate agreement with the district that does not include any.
So Mary Topliff has a contract with the district?
Yes.
And so she'll be, her name will show up on here when she bills us?
Yes.
Okay, so for anybody looking to find out about costs for the investigation, Mary Topliff's name would be an indication of billing for the investigation, but of course there were additional costs from Hanson Bridget. I don't know how much, because they had their attorneys reviewing her work. Thank you.
Okay, I have a comment. I don't know who this is from. Who is it from? James?
James.
Hi, thank you for taking my comment. I'll make it brief. In the past, commissioner discussion under bills and claims has been used in a retaliatory manner, mostly to bring up legal fees that Commissioner Brennan has incurred as a member of the board. Your previous motion was retaliatory. Thank you, President Ciancarelli.
Okay, any other comments on the consent item, consent calendar item one? Is there a motion to approve the bills and claims? Our treasurer?
Motion to move that we approve item one, bills and claims, in the amount of $483,994.26. I reviewed all charges and they all seem good.
There a second?
Second.
Roll call, please.
Commissioner Matouche?
Aye.
Commissioner Lorenz?
Aye.
President Ciancarelli?
Aye.
Commissioner Brennan?
Aye.
Commissioner Bernardo?
Aye.
The motion carries unanimously. We have 2 minutes left. You have another item that you pulled off, Sabrina, item 12, which I think is something that hopefully we can conclude quickly, because I think I know why you pulled it off.
Item 12?
Yes. Which is
corrected,
the point, the correction.
I just wanted to know what the change was.
Oh.
I had two hoists reversed on the graphic.
Okay.
So basically, the resolution, Sabrina, says that it's the northeast corner and it should be northwest. So that's that minor change, but.
I just have two.
But it's still in keeping with your interim solution.
So I move that we approve.
I'll second. Roll call, please.
Commissioner Brennan?
Aye.
Commissioner Mathush?
Aye.
Commissioner Lourenes?
Aye.
Commissioner Bernardo?
Aye.
President Chancarella?
Aye, so that motion carries unanimously. It is 9:29 right now, so if there's a motion to adjourn, we'll get to the other consent items later. And Sabrina, do you want to pass?
I'd like to keep it.
Well, so here's my.
Okay, is there a motion to adjourn?
Wait, there's something.
I move that we adjourn.
Sorry, what?
Oh, second that we adjourn.
Okay, roll call, please.
Okay. Commissioner Lourenes?
Aye.
President Chancarelli?
Aye.
Commissioner Bernardo?
Aye.
Commissioner Brennan?
Aye.
Commissioner Mathush?
Aye.
Motion carries. The meeting is adjourned at 9:30.